Hello friends, MK here with another Animal Crossing video because of course I am. This channel should be called Casual Crossing, am I right? I do hope to get around to featuring other games eventually, but Animal Crossing has just captured my attention since I started playing in October, and I'm absolutely enamored with it, so of course I'm going to get into the hobby of making videos with it. And it's been a long time in the making because I have a second island underway. I wanted to feature the start of the second island for a couple of reasons. The second island isn't going to be Evercute 2.0, and I have plans to turn it into a dream address maze for the community to race around the Halloween season. So there's going to be plot, and there's going to be drama, there's going to be shenanigans afoot, and honestly, after playing the first week, my fears of there not being any content completely evaporated due to the seasonal nightmare that fell upon my island in its early days, but I'll get to that later. The other reason why I wanted to feature the early days of this new island is after a year since the release of Animal Crossing New Horizons, we're still getting new players to the game. And with seeing the millions of beautiful islands featured on YouTube, on Instagram, on Reddit, any form of social media at this point, it's easy to be overwhelmed and intimidated and feeling like your island is an undeserving dumpster fire. But the reality is that we all start with trash islands. We all start with that one-star rank. And it's always going to be a grind, even with my first island providing a stack of resources and a million bells, because we all start at this beginning. And this is what I wanted to share. I wanted to share this beginning with you guys. So folks, I anticipated this video featuring a lot of the grind that we expect to have during the first week playing. And, you know, a new baby YouTube video person thing with starry eyes and rose-colored glasses and a very basic understanding of video editing and YouTube in general, thought that I'd be able to do a week's grind in a day or two and edit the videos with ease and post an entertaining series of videos one after the other. And that was a nope. That was a dose of humble pie right there, because when you've been playing for 5 months and unlocked most of the game, and you watch other YouTubers regularly post what appears to be effortless but fantastic and relatable content, you forget just how easy it is to, one, burn out, and also forget that video editing is a lot of work, especially when you're first starting out. And it also just felt kind of boring and repetitive to simply speed up all the tree chopping and the rock hitting and the museum curating, and so I'll provide a link to Rush Rustic's week 1 and 2 walkthrough guide that I use for both islands, and that's found on polygon.com. But you know, that series of videos, it's just one video right now, because really you just need the one video to start the journey. And I hope to have a couple of live streams on developing my island and raising it from where it is now to get to KK Slider visiting the island and unlocking terraforming and, you know, the roads and stuff. The other thing that I low-key dreaded but thought would be entertaining as hell was the possibility of having to restart my island over and over to get the right layout and the right starter villagers and even the right campsite villager. But I ended up not having to do that. You know, I got peaches instead of pears, I got the opposite river outlet, and the two starting villagers whose house exterior matched the theme for the front of the island. And we'll also dive into my fears of getting the wrong campsite villager, because it wasn't enough to not want the smug villagers that I'd already had on Everkeep. There are a couple of smugs that rub me the wrong way, and it's controversial, actually. But, you know, the start of the game still gets to me. It was hard to deal with the tutorial aspect of not having a Nook phone or a map, but it set the tone for the game and allowed me to get immersed in this new resident representative's perspective of their current situation. So this is where we are. Hi, hello. My island has moved up in the world from being an incredibly deserted God's forsaken hunk of land in the middle of nowhere to a slightly less deserted God's forsaken rock in the middle of nowhere. We've got Nook's Cranny in its second Pokemon form. We've got NPCs visiting the updated resident services building. Hi, Leaf Honey. Edge DIY, please and thank you. I've literally bought from you 3 times and over 20,000 bells. And with the resources and bells from Everkeep, I've upgraded my house to 4 rooms that will hold onto that for now. And this is Iram, with the incredibly imaginative name of Mori being backwards. They're Taurus, and her fellow adventurers are Agnes, who I'd actually really hoped to have, and Coach, who is starting to grow on me, I'm not gonna lie. I've also never had a bull villager before, so that was exciting. And one day I'll have Antonio. But I'm currently very happy with what my starting point is. And I cannot reiterate enough that week one walkthrough guide that I mentioned, because it is a literal time saver. It let me bullet point the objectives instead of running around aimlessly, even during the tutorial when you first arrive. And I mean, it was still pretty aimless a lot of the time because, you know, new island energy, heck yeah, but there was a little rhyme and reason to my madness. And you really need to get through that grind to get going and move the story along. But there is something truly unique to starting back up again with a second island. You pick up on a lot of the tongue-in-cheek humor that you may have missed the first time around, the absolute unfairness of expecting one person, i.e. you, to do a lot of the work for some getaway package deal that's supposed to be a vacay. And, you know, in this case, what were Agnes and Coach doing? Sweeping literal dirt on a deserted island and looking adorable. And here you are, here I am, running around and gathering supplies for freaking survival. So in this case, the story is going to write itself, which is why I feel Animal Crossing New Horizons is a fantastic game. That deserves all the hype. I think Nintendo expects you to be as witty and dark humored and mean as the villagers are to your character in previous games, and this game allows you to experience the benefit and the flaws of Nook Inc.'s business model, which in my humble opinion acts as both as a criticism to certain capitalistic practices, but also that utopian practice of removing the exploitative practice of interest rates on loans. Lots of practice mentioned there. But anyway, I will say though, the snark really hit ahead when Iram was named resident representative. Up until that point, their hope was to escape and start anew from the paranormal shenanigans that I have a headcanon for, and all they want to do is open a cafe on the island, live simply with the pleasures of a small city life, and being named resident representative was not what they had planned at all. Whatsoever. And here's what gets to me. You are an actual stranger to these people. Tom Nook has only interacted with you for a couple of hours at most, and he's decided to entrust you with an important job because you picked fruit and you named the island. I'm not really a snarky person. I'm really not. I'm not good at pretend snark in the slightest, but when you play this game a second time around, you realize the snark has been inside you all along, and it's glorious. And there's no mention of a contract, there's no mention of payment. And so here I'm thinking, oh, this is an unpaid internship, isn't it? This is us getting paid with exposure or experience. And to be fair to Nintendo, to be fair, we do have an almost authoritarian control of the island, what gets built, what gets demolished, what moves where, who is allowed to live on the island, who is allowed to leave. And really, the only things that we can't do is move resident services or have more than 8 bridges and inclines at a time. Like, gods, Nintendo, stop being such a dictator of our creative, misunderstood souls and give us what we want. I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding. But this is me absolutely getting ahead of myself, putting the cart before the horse. The start of Oldport begins with Iram, Agnes, Coach, Mr. Nook, and the twins, just like any other island, each with their own aspirations for the island itself. And it's Iram's hope to make a modest, albeit intimidating, start a fun one regardless. As I said, Iram is going to run the city cafe. And when I begin moving buildings to terraform the front of the island, I'm thinking of putting their home close to the airport entrance. This is something I'm actually really intimidated about because I plan to have the front of the island super developed and very much like a city, which is not my forte in the slightest, but again, I'm getting ahead of myself. So the first day was a literal blur, and it started off with getting the Nook phone. Hallelujah! 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 Ah yes, the Nook phone. And the itemized bill conveniently converted from bells I didn't have to a mileage program I was voluntold to sign up for. This deserted island package kind of reminded me of the American healthcare system, you know, where you get treated and then told how much it is after they save your life and you go into crippling debt. And here, you get to a deserted island under the control of a business tycoon and his associates, given a literal job as a local hire without contract or pay, and it's weird to me that you don't pay for a vacation ahead of time. Maybe I'm weird in my past transactions for traveling to have, I don't know, realistic expectations to pay before you go, but I think Mr. Nook needs to work on his travel package and maybe have his clients pay ahead of time. And not once did Agnes or Coach talk about paying off their expenses. I mean, is that rude though, to discuss debt with strangers? We're literally on a deserted island. We're practically family at this point due to forced proximity. So here I was, chopping trees, weeding, fishing, everything and more, and I'd often see Agnes and Coach without a care in the world, wishing I too could give zero fricks on my quote-unquote vacation, but I wasn't bitter. I wasn't bitter. No, seriously, I wasn't bitter. Not at Agnes and Coach anyway. But in fact, you know, it was my first five villagers who have been nothing but incredibly kind and generous. They've given me gifts as new neighbors, I've been given new DIYs, and I really lucked out with my next three villagers. I used Nook Miles tickets and found Ozzy right out of the gate, who is a total sweetie, just a cutie pie. And I had no complaints, it was a great start. And then we had Nana, who is also adorable. And then we have Winnie, who, you know, we'll get to Winnie in a minute. But here is where Iram's paranormal shenanigans begins. It started with Ozzy's move to the island. So at this point, we have three villagers, two Nookling twins, and a resident representative, a freaking Toy Day classic tune, and the return of our favorite wino. And I thought Gulliver was literally the only character in this game that I'd willingly hit with a net. It's more fun to wake him up with a net because it shows how tired you are of his crap, and I'd already seen him once before. I'd really like to have my villagers come up to me and go, ugh, he's back, and I know exactly who they're talking about. But no, oh no, there's another NPC who has earned the net, and of course I'm, oh my god, I'm talking about this being. Right here. This is very much a nope, 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 Jesus take the wheel scenario. And if you don't know who this is, let me introduce to you Zipper. Like, I don't even have the right expressions handy for such a scary encounter. And I had mentally and emotionally prepared myself for Bunny Day, even with the changes Nintendo had made to this year's festivities and seeing all the memes, literally all the memes, Zipper still produced that visceral panic of having a masked serial killer in the area. I'd say that there are a couple of villagers who give off serial killer vibes with their appearance, questionable boundaries, and poor conversation choices, but oh my god, Zipper really does live up to the hype of being terrifying. And here's the thing, I am not a horror buff. In the slightest. I don't like scary movies. I don't like how serial killers are romanticized, specifically in American culture. That's not to say it's wrong to have morbid fascinations with death, cults, or other taboo topics, because look at me, I'd be a huge hypocrite after making this video. But there is something incredibly special about starting an island right around Bunny Day, because last year the game's release was at least a couple of weeks before the 2 weeks long hell that led up to Bunny Day. People likely already had unlocked KK Slider's concert, had 10 villagers, had a means to escape the pastel onslaught somehow. And despite Bunny Day toning down a lot this year, I felt psychologically trapped on a virtual island with no means to leave an NPC that screams stranger danger to me. And especially when he was talking about having buried things for me to find. I'm not a big Easter celebrating person, but Zipper had this hypnotic capability of getting you to effectively do his bidding. You know, all hail our bunny Lord Zipper. And I felt like I fell into a trance of searching out these hidden treasures, because we all know it's bodies, we all know this, and wearing his brand because my lizard brain felt that there was a threatening force in my territory and I had to do certain things to alleviate the threat. I even started, you know, with genuine concern, checking to see where my other villagers were on the island before running into my home in terror. And so, you know, I had seen Ozzy already, I passed by Coach, and Agnes was being a good little introvert, and this is where it starts getting super, super weird. So, like any dumb protagonist in a horror movie, I decided to roam around my island in the evening for the first time, dressed like the knight in case it became, you know, Animal Crossing's the slasher without me knowing, and with only my tools to defend me from the masked menace. I was acting business as usual, you know, drop off the fossils to assess later, being really proud of the fact that my museum is updated, and whistling really, really casually while I tightly held on to the net that, let's be real, can only do so much. I worked my way toward Ozzy just to make sure he was still okay, because, you know, how unfair is it to end up in a horror movie without your consent? And then I went to pick up some shells, because what is there even to do at this point but wait for your doom? And I ended up picking up the first of many hidden messages from Zipper. Because at this point, I was invested, y'all. I was super invested. I was going to protect my island by any means necessary, even if it meant my descent into Zipper's madness and doing his DIYs and just falling into the depths of his glassy, soulless eyes. And even then, like, look at this. It gets me every time. Zipper hopping around in the middle of the night is nightmare fuel. Come find where I buried the bodies for low-quality chocolate, children. Like, Jesus! Yeah, no, that's enough. No, I need to find an adult on this island. And the Nook twins were not very helpful. They seemed to believe having a killer on the island was just dandy. So when I left the store, I kind of, you know, I went extreme, pretty extreme. I held the axe up until I talked to him again. And this time was fully complicit in his dark, nefarious schemes. Like, way to make a witness, Zipper, seriously. But I weirdly got into it. You know, I felt like I was a case study of fulfilling the demands of a deranged lunatic, showering him with gifts of, like, a fearful follower in the hands of an angry god. I even went so far as setting up a shrine in my house with the outfit I intend to wear on Sunday. It was bananas, y'all. Bananas. So I set him up with a few DIYs, hoping, you know, it was enough for him to not kill us in our sleep. It was terrifying. I really enjoyed it, though. It was super fun. It really was. So after I set him up with a few DIYs outside, hoping it was enough, I checked on Ozzy. Just one more time, internally apologizing for unintentionally inviting him to his doom. But, you know, Ozzy being Ozzy, he's a ray of freaking sunshine. He'll be fine. I'm super excited to have him on my island. But oh my god, poor unassuming Nana, who'd arrived after Zipper mysteriously disappeared. She has no idea, literally no idea, what's in store for the island. I feel really bad for her. But let's talk about Winnie for a minute. Winnie, our sweet girl. Do you remember when I said we'd get back to Winnie? Well, she had also arrived after Zipper disappeared, but her zealous excitement has me thinking that we may have a literal Zipper cult member on the island. You know, instead of the fearful acceptance, like I'm having to mentally jump through hoops for, she gleefully accepts Zipper's reign of terror on the island. But in all seriousness, I'm getting into it. The bunny DIYs are growing on me. It's not my usual vibe, but it's not bad. And we finally get to the final piece that has led up to this week, which is making the campsite to invite our sixth villager. I will say, after a week in the game, over a span of a couple of days, I am tired, folks. I'm so tired. I don't recommend doing what I did as a first timer, not because that I feel time traveling is wrong. I do it on this island and I do it on Everkeep, but because the first week is emotionally taxing. But I have the house to how I want it so far, and I'll give you a quick tour before putting up the campsite. So as you saw, the front room is the main cafe area, and in the back is the bedroom. It's still in boxes, kind of like Iram is still settling in. It looks like grandma's spare bedroom, and I absolutely love it. But this is not its final look in the slightest. But it's to kind of add that feeling of building up the island, and I find that aspect super endearing. Now, as for my campsite, hi, Leaf. Where's my hedge DIY? No? Just Cosmos? Really? Rude. Anyway, my plan is to put the campsite by the pier, which will act like a ferry service to the island. And this is really where civilization will stop on the island. The remaining four villagers will be in the forested area in the back for plot reasons. But I'll admit I was nervous about my camp villager. Again, for the sake of plot, I wanted a villager whose house exterior looked like a house that you'd see in a town, and I didn't want a villager that I'd already had before, so no Graham, no Shep, no Kid, and for the love of God, no Raymond or Marshall. And I mean, I guess Marshall is fine, I guess, but I really don't understand the hype for Raymond at all. And it only hit me until recently why I don't like him, because, you know, similar to how Zipper brings out that masked killer phobia, Raymond, to me, reminds me of the romanticized serial killer archetype. That smooth-talking, handsome, unassuming neighbor that'll eat your eyeballs. And I've read Caitlin Doughty's Will My Cat Eat My Eyeballs? Raymond would absolutely eat your face if he could. But anyway, that's my personal issue with Raymond. It would be hilarious if he was still my sixth villager in the end, but, you know, because who doesn't want a nemesis, am I right? But who knows, maybe he'd be a frenemy. An enemend? I don't even know anymore. This video is so, so long. But here we are. We've made the campsite. We're getting to that point where we have our first visitor, and I was super nervous. It was the all or nothing. Would I get that nemesis who ultimately won me over before taking over the island in a cannibalistic frenzy? Would I get that villager with the wrong house exterior that meant redoing the whole game? Would Ed, Iram's therapist in my headcanon, end up on the island as old or its only sane person with actual healthy boundaries? Most of the smugs would be fine, but there was just so much writing on this moment. And who did we get? We got Colton, my literal prince, my overly fond of himself, using other languages to sound smarter, bae. You have no idea how excited I was to see his pretty blonde princely face. And I was okay to having two horse villagers now. I know that I was very big on having different species, but I was okay with this. This to me was absolutely fine. So I continued to shed flowers at Colton for a good ungodly and an inappropriate 30 seconds, and it was here that I started thinking, there's something super special about your first 10 villagers. I feel like they treat you differently. And maybe that's because there's more for them to do for you in the start. You know, they provide reactions, they give you the starting DIYs, there's helpful tips on how to really build up your island from the ground up. But I'm already getting such a different energy on Old Port than I already see on Everkeep. And sure, Winnie's house is a little different than everyone else's, but again, this was a great start to what I think will be a fun island. I already have a heading to how I want to build it, with an orchard and a small farm to the campsite, the stores and Iram's cafe right by the airport. It's going to be so fun to record the process. Like, this just brings me such joy, and I can't wait to share this with you. But this is where I wanted to stop before doing live streams to build the island. We're going to stop at the star rank system. I didn't intend on having randoms fill the remaining four, but because my two accounts interacted, Nintendo ended up putting my voided characters in front of the queue, and so Naomi, who I'd had on Everkeep, moved in. And that's fine. I have no issue with that blue bovine beauty gracing me with her presence on this island, but I ended up going villager hunting for villagers 8 and 9 and got Pashmina and Walt, which is so cool. I like the both of them already. The 10th villager will be a villager hunt livestream sometime soon. I'm thinking in the next couple of days, especially after Bunny Day, because Bunny Day has its own video coming up, I think. And with Everkeep, I did a literal jump from a 1-star rating to a 5-star rating simply by putting down stone fencing everywhere, like ruins and log stakes on the beach. But for Old Port, I'm sticking with 9 villagers for now until we get the KK Slider visit, and focusing on the outskirts of the main city area since that will be torn down anyway when I get terraforming unlocked. I've already weeded the entire island, which bumped up my ranking to 2 stars, and I have all the fruit trees and random flowers planted, 2 inclines and 3 bridges, and aside from the exterior furniture I was required to build, there's not much else going for Old Port at the moment, but to me, that's okay. I think this is going to be a solid start.